Glad to see all of you here tonight. For those of you who are visitors, my name is Father Novak. I'm the pastor here at St. Francis, and I have a confession to make. And that is, when this whole idea about the St. Francis talks came about, it really was because I wanted to do a talk on Catholic architecture, okay? So everything else was just a reason to have this talk tonight. Those of you who know me know that I love these sorts of things, and I'm so happy that we have Art Loesen here with us tonight as our presenter and speaker. Just a couple of housekeeping items for those of you who are interested. There are women's room. The women's room is here, and the men's room is over there. And you know, go ahead and get up during his talk if you want to. Everyone will know what you're doing because it's right there. Okay. So sorry, it's not. This was a chapel. This was a church to start out with, not a parish hall. To lead off tonight, I want to, as our opening prayer, read a passage from a prayer from the dedication of a church. And this, what did I do with my book? There it is. So it is very rare that a church is dedicated, only once, really. And for those of you who are here for our first Mass in the newly renovated church, it was a Mass. It was not a Mass of dedication or rededication. But this is the preface for the Mass of a dedication of a church. And none of us were here when St. Francis was dedicated 75 years ago. But like all of our Catholic prayers, the prayers reveal so much of what we believe. And this one in particular speaks very much about our faith in relation to the buildings that we worship in. You want to be my altar server?
Sure, I'll
hold. Okay. Keep it steady. There was a server the other day that it was turned like this. I could not see anything. I was like, you know, and he was like under the weight of it. We're in this period now where we have the fifth graders, the new servers, okay? So they're, it's comical. You probably watch it, so you see it. Let us pray. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Father most holy. For you have made the whole world a temple of your glory, that your name might everywhere be extolled. Yet you allow us to consecrate to you apt places for the divine mysteries. And so we dedicate joyfully to your majesty this house of prayer, built by human labor. Here is foreshadowed the mystery of the true temple. Here is prefigured the heavenly Jerusalem. For you made the body of your Son, born of the tender Virgin, the temple consecrated to you, in which the fullness of the Godhead might dwell. You also established the church as a holy city, built upon the foundation of the apostles, with Jesus Christ himself, the chief cornerstone, a city to be built of chosen stones, given life by the Spirit and bonded by charity, where for ages, endless ages, you will be all in all, and the light of Christ will shine undimmed forever. We ask these things in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, who gathers us together this evening, who blesses us and sustains us with his wisdom and knowledge. May we be open to doing his will in our lives and uniting ourselves to the proclamation of his gospel, we the living stones of the church. We ask these things in his name, for he lives and reigns forever and ever.
Amen.
Okay, without further ado, I do want to introduce to you our speaker tonight, Mr. Art Loesen. Art and I have known each other for a number of years. He actually gave a similar presentation to the priest, that's been 5 or 6 years ago, way before we started the building of the shrine. And from the very beginning of the shrine, we wanted to get an architect for this project that understands how to build a traditional Catholic church. And we did a national search, and Art and his partner, Michael, were our lead. They interviewed for the position, and of course they won the contract. And so we're so happy. I've got to become good friends with Art and his wife, and he comes here on a regular basis, because if you haven't noticed, we're building this church down on the south side, and it takes a lot from an architect and the contractors and all of us to make it happen. So please join me in welcoming Art Loesen.
Do I need to use both microphones? Good. Which means that I apologize for having to stand not in front of only in front of the bathrooms, but in front of the buffet bar as well. So no hard feelings if anyone gets a little peckish in the middle. So it's a real pleasure to be here with you this evening to share some of what I've learned about the tradition of on the impact of architecture on our character of the buildings that we encounter does not define how we behave in them. The way we dress, the way we act, the way we speak is different if we're walking into a courthouse than if we're walking into an office building. The architecture sets the tone, expressing and reinforcing the shared social patterns that make us who we are. The way we behave in a sports arena is fundamentally different than how we behave at a memorial. But there are no signs or attendants telling us how to behave to explain the rules. The architecture, its form, its scale, its materials, all create a character that we understand and can relate to in reference to previous experiences with similar spaces. This shared tradition of experiences is a critical part of a society. It's a reflection of our common ground, our common values, and the common good. Architecture that intentionally abandons those shared traditions, as much modern architecture can, erodes those shared experiences and values. Here at the National Gallery of Art, there's no doubt how you're to behave in the older West Wing on the right. But the East Wing was intentionally designed to look more like a shopping mall or a hotel lobby. A much more ambiguous space, leaving uncertainty about what happens to the microphone. Is this better?
Yes.
Very good. Okay, starting over. So the East Wing was designed quite intentionally.
So,
no? Better? Okay. All right, we're going to do this. The what? Is it making a buzzing sound?
closer. I'm sorry. Let's do this. And then that might help. Keep a little bit more. Yeah.
Is that better?
Testing 1, 2, 3. Yeah, it still does. It does. We have problems with this. Yeah. Okay. Just do your best. You got it.
Okay. But if I talk louder, it buzzes. Back to the East Wing. Creating something that looks more like a shopping mall or a hotel lobby creates something that's much more ambiguous about what's supposed to happen and how you're supposed to act. We see this also in the way that we encounter art. Of these two statues, which is inviting you toward a closer encounter and which is pushing you further away? And this is true in Catholic churches as well. A church that is part of the architectural tradition of the Roman Catholic Church, in other words, a church that looks like a church, is a much more effective tool in focusing your heart and your mind that you are in the real presence of the Lord, of engaging you in the sacred mystery and the visceral reality of the Mass. So we come to Thomas Aquinas, who explains that there is nothing in the mind that was not first in the senses. This means that everything we have learned, from how to walk to integral calculus, has come to us by what we experience. What we see, hear, smell, touch, and taste, and this is how we encounter Christ. Our senses are constantly bombarded by all sorts of stimuli that we cannot control. Work, school, family life. There are so many things vying for our attention at all times. To get to Mass on a Sunday morning, you have to get the kids out of bed, get everybody in the car, realize that the car needs gas, find a parking space, get a new microphone.
The live stream's good. They've had it.
I was saying something about distractions. Can we hear that? Yes. All right, there we go. So, those distractions that affect us each and every day in everything that we do. Where's Father Novak? This wasn't in my rider. Oh, no good. Okay. Well, let's try it the old-fashioned way. Can everybody hear me now?
Yes.
Great. I apologize for yelling, but I have kids, so I'm used to it. So just the act of getting to Mass on a Sunday morning, for most of us, is an exercise of just meeting a deadline and trying to get into the pew before Father starts the procession, right? And that's not a proper transition from our daily lives into the presence of God, which is what it's supposed to be. And the best example of how architecture can change that is how you experience a church in Rome. Anyone who hasn't been, you simply have to go as soon as we get the COVID stuff sorted out, go and spend a week in Italy. A typical street in Rome is a busy press of people moving in different directions. It's hot, it's noisy, it smells like two-cycle Vespa exhaust, and you walk into a random church. Not one of the ones on the guidebook, just here's a church, let's walk into the back of it. You walk through a creaky wooden vestibule door and you have to stop because it's dark, your eyes have to adjust, and in that 30 seconds you realize that it's cool, it's quiet, there's a vague smell of incense. And if you're lucky, you happen to be there on the Tuesday morning when the organist is practicing, and you have this sense of this outstanding, beautiful music that you've never heard before. And in that instant, through all of your senses, you realize that you're transitioning from the hustle and bustle, the hectic life of the real world into someplace completely different. And that's what the architecture is doing through all of their senses. So let's talk about the sacred mysteries. We have always gone to a place apart to encounter God. Moses ascended the mountain and found God in the burning bush. He went out alone to receive the Ten Commandments. Abraham led Isaac to be sacrificed. Christ went to the desert to be tempted, retreated into the Garden of Gethsemane to pray. Each of these represents a precinct set apart from the rest of the world. The greatest ancient venue for communion with God was the Temple of Solomon. Built 1,000 years before Christ, the design of the temple was given to King David, who then passed it along to his son by God. As an architect, I find it fascinating that God gave the design of a building. It must therefore be a pretty important building. And that temple, as the purest example God intends for mankind to encounter him in worship. In this temple, you see many of the elements that still exist in a Catholic church of today. You have a clear threshold between the world and the temple grounds. The altar of sacrifice is surrounded by the communion. An inner sanctuary for the priests and the Holy of Holies, where the Ark of the Covenant was kept. And even after 3,000 years, those elements are still recognizable in the form of a Catholic church today. The forecourt in front of the church, the exonarthex, is a place of gathering before and after the Mass. That narthex is the threshold, the vestibule where you gather yourself before entering into the sacred church. The congregation faces the altar, and behind it is the tabernacle, housing not the ark, but the body of Christ. The Catholic Church remains a legible embodiment of the Temple of Solomon. This tradition is not merely comfortable and quaint, it's conveying real meaning about our Catholic faith. Inside the church is a sacred place, set apart from the rest of the world. It's designed to engage all of the senses in a positive way, to be a place of wonder and awe befitting its purpose. Noble materials, solid construction, and a timeless design that will never be out of date. That's what defines a Catholic church. But what is beauty, really, and why are we attracted to it? St. John Paul II put it well in his letter to artists, in which he called beauty the visible form of the good, along with the other transcendentals, such as truth and goodness. Beauty is made perfect in the nature of God. True beauty is absolute, undeniable, and transcends simple aesthetic preferences. And it is a path to encountering God. The transcendentals are aspects of being that you and I can perceive and understand as humans. But we can see that one thing is more or less true, more or less good, more or less beautiful than another. As we see here, one of these churches can objectively be described as being more beautiful than the other. We can imagine, we can perceive that there is such a thing as absolute beauty. If we had a picture that was even more beautiful than the church on the right and kept going and going and going, we get to something that is absolutely, fundamentally, beauty itself. That perfect beauty, perfect goodness, perfect truth is a way of understanding God. And that beauty here on earth is a way of encountering and experiencing God. So If God can be described as the perfection of beauty, and we're created in His image, then it's just perfectly natural that we all have this thirst, this hunger for beauty in our lives. It's part of our very human nature. And we see this throughout human history, even predating Christianity. The Greeks took great pains to introduce subtle curves and visual corrections in their temples. You see on the left, that's slightly cut off, the steps of every Greek temple are curved ever so slightly. You need a laser to figure it out, to see it today. But every single one is designed in that way, and the columns lean in ever so slightly, because the Greeks learned that that proportionally made them look upright. For someone to spend that kind of time and energy to figure that out and to pursue that and to perfect it 2,000 years ago, I find fantastically impressive. That was very important to them. And the same thing with the Romans. You see the Pantheon on the right. They were pragmatic engineers building aqueducts and roads, but the buildings they created were not only functional, they were beautiful. The dome you see here is poured of concrete 2,000 years before we remembered what concrete really was. It was the largest dome that was ever built until the Renaissance. And they realized that they needed to lighten it up as it got taller. And they did that by introducing these coffers. They could have done that with simple squares, but they didn't. They did it as a series of nested coffers that diminish as they go up, accentuating the height and the perspective of the dome. That was much harder to do than just pouring a solid concrete dome, but they did it because it was beautiful. But if there's one thing that I want you to remember from tonight, aside from just talk louder and forget the microphones, let it be this. We've all been told that beauty is in the eye of the beholder. But that's only true if the eye in question has been properly formed. If my eye cannot understand and appreciate true beauty, the statement simply justifies relativism, that my reality is different than yours, that there are no absolutes, and therefore no God. This simple phrase has been used to justify an endless stream of terrible art and architecture over the last century, in my opinion. But with a solid formation in the traditions of Catholic art and architecture, we know that true beauty is not a matter of taste or preference. Instead, it's an experience of the divine here on earth. If anyone ever makes this statement to you, please remind them that it is only true if the eye in question has been formed to appreciate true beauty. So a Catholic church should be beautiful, but it should also look like a church. It should be designed to reflect the millennia of its history and tradition. I can show either of these two images to almost anyone who would not only be able to identify them as churches, but more than likely to know that they're Catholic churches. That's the power of a coherent architecture and tradition of beauty. This importance of beauty was well understood by the Catholic Church. At the conclusion of the Second Vatican Council, Pope Paul VI included these lines in his message to artists, reminding us that beauty is necessary and unites the generations in the timeless tradition of the Church. But we can't just say that beauty is nice. It's nice if we can have it, if you can manage it at your parish. I argue that beauty is not a luxury, it's a fundamental necessity. Ironically, it's not God that needs a beautiful church. Christ told us to retreat to our inner room to pray to our Father. Matthew here seems to be saying that a showy church would really be pretty hypocritical, and that there's no way that we could please God by building the most beautiful building here on earth. If God is perfect beauty, anything we could create would be a pale and distant imitation of his presence. But we remember that Christ entered the world as a poor, defenseless infant. He knew poverty, fear, rejection, and pain from the flight into Egypt through his death on the cross. Likewise, God is always with us. He finds us at our lowest and most vulnerable. There's no need to kneel down in a church, a beautiful church even, for your prayer to be heard. In fact, we're the ones who need beauty in a church. Remembering those words of Churchill, the church that we build forms us. A beautiful church in which the presence of God can be directly experienced through our senses is helping us to more fully practice our faith and to worship in a much more meaningful manner. We need to experience the wonder and awe of God's presence, to be still and know that He is God. So why aren't all Catholic churches beautiful? There's been a long narrative, honestly coming from a lot of artists and architects, that the Second Vatican Council decreed that the design of churches had to change. The actual documents of the council are not prescriptive at all, and only indirectly mention architectural style, noting that styles from any period are acceptable. The architectural and artistic traditions of our church are to be carefully preserved. There's also a mention that the goal is noble beauty rather than a sumptuous display, which is an important point to remember. So we come to the question of modern architecture. Is it possible to design a modern church that is beautiful? And I would argue that it is indeed possible, but it's rare and exceedingly expensive. Modern churches can be expressions of an architectural or sometimes even a liturgical ego. Of the two images above, which one would inspire you to ask, who is the architect of that? It's what I like to call the difference between I and we. One of these churches is a very idiosyncratic expression by an individual, and one is grounded in a 3,000-year continuum. The design of a beautiful church requires humility and submission to the traditions of the church. And I have to note that I find it wonderfully ironic to stand here as an architect and tell you how humble I have to be in my work, which is not a very humble thing to say. We see the same thing in sacred art. The Station of the Cross on the left, which happens to be from my own parish church in Washington, D.C., is dated and not terribly inspiring. The painting on the right, though done much more recently, is a much more timeless expression of the crucifixion. Which one of these two does a better job at conveying the meaning and significance of this scene? And which of these two will do that for the next 100 years? But I'm willing to bet that most of you didn't come tonight to hear an architect struggle through his explanation of why beauty is so important to the church. Maybe some of you did, maybe it was the wine and cheese, but it's a lot more fun to look at some examples of how beautiful churches are being built today. So let's do that. This is the before picture. No, sorry. No, we'll start right here at St. Francis of Assisi. There's a consistency and of the architectural quality throughout this campus. Noble materials, great proportions, a wonderfully intimate scale, great lighting that accentuates rather than washes out. It's an excellent example of a talented pastor and a very supportive parish. Well done. And you may be aware of a new church that's being built down south, just off I-35. It's been a great joy to be a part of the Blessed Stanley Rother Shrine project, and it's very exciting to see it taking shape. Designed to be reminiscent of the mission churches where Father Stanley served in Guatemala, this 2,000-seat church will not just be a large church for the Archdiocese. It'll be a place of pilgrimage for Catholics from around the country. The interior features a very dramatic central dome and the sanctuary will be filled with hand-carved wooden altar and statues. There are places for additional statues, sacred art, and stained glass to finish the decoration of this church over time. There's an ambulatory or side aisle that allows you to circulate around the main nave and leads you back to the very intimate chapel dedicated to Blessed Stanley Rother. There you will encounter the tomb of the Father Stanley, surmounted by a mural of him being received into heaven by Christ. It'll be a truly special place of prayer. And until it's completed, this is about as close as we can get to experiencing it. Oh, now the audio works. Coming soon.
Yes.
And pretty drawings and computer models are great, but we prefer to show projects that are actually built. This is St. Francis Xavier Catholic Church just up the road in Stillwater. It seats 850 people and features a full suite of offices, a parish hall, classrooms for religious education, a large youth center. The exterior is a blend of earth-toned brick in an architectural style that was described by the pastor as Cimarron Gothic. So that's what we call it. On the interior, we have a soaring nave with glass fiber reinforced plaster, wonderful material that's molded. You can make repetitive shapes very cost effectively. That's how we formed those ribs in the vaults. The reredos that you see here was hand carved to our design in northern Italy and delivered to Oklahoma. That's the same company that's making a lot of the elements for the Rother Shrine project. The parish is getting ready to celebrate their third anniversary next March 11th, coming up. And this is a church we designed in Leesburg, Virginia. It seats 1,100. It's located right on the edge of a historic district in the small town in rural Virginia, using the red brick and the limestone accents to blend in with the smaller historic buildings. The reredos that you see here behind the main altar was salvaged from a closed church in Newark, New Jersey, stored for a year and reinstalled here in this new church. And just to demonstrate that not every church has to seat 1,100 people, this is a private chapel that we did on the eastern shore of Maryland. It seats 12, and those 12 have to be on very friendly terms. It's a beautiful and sacred space built out of very traditional materials, very traditional techniques, and it was just a joy to be a part of. Both of those projects had significant, but not outrageous, budgets. But this is a new church at the other end of the cost spectrum. This was built in Chesapeake, Virginia, which is just outside of Norfolk. It seats 300. Inside the nave is a simple yet well-proportioned space. The structural system, those white arches that you see, are glue lambs, more commonly used in dairy barns. We used them here and painted them to accent their vertical nature, very cost-effective way to build the building. The underside of the roof deck that you see here, the ceiling, is really just the structural wood deck. We stained it dark, again, to make best use of the material. The floor is stained concrete. Whoops, and I skipped ahead. The floor is stained concrete. The windows are Marvin windows in a standard size. By being very cost-effective about what we did on the interior, we were able to save some of the budget to do some of the details on the exterior, to do the clipped gable roof on the end, and those stepped brick details, all of which are very Tidewater Virginia details that most churches at this budget could have never achieved. But by getting the proportions right, we didn't have to spend a lot of money on the interior. Again, going back to the Second Vatican Council, the promulgation of sacred beauty, not sumptuous display. And here we have a chapel. This is the before and after pictures for the Sisters of Life, their mother house in Suffern, New York. Cardinal Dolan gave them this wonderful house that hadn't been touched since 1942, had this decrepit chapel in it that was really in tough shape. And they asked us, how do we fix this up with no money? And we said, well, you need a little bit of money, but then we can fix it up. We put new limestone flooring in. They salvaged some pews from a church and reused them. They had an altar that they were able to relocate. But we were able to do a lot with just cleaning the aesthetics up, introducing the new statues that they had relocated. And this is a wonderful example that lighting and a coat of paint can do a lot for a space. You see that behind the statues, it looks like we have a niche behind the statues. It's actually a flat piece of drywall. There's a flat piece of trim that goes up and around it, and the center is painted a slightly different color. That same color is used on the ceiling. And we like to say that a can of purple paint costs exactly the same as a can of white paint. So if you can use that color creatively, you can get a lot of bang for the buck. So the Cardinal dedicated this chapel, I think, 5 years ago, and they've been thrilled with it ever since. And several months ago, I was having dinner with a priest here in Oklahoma City who asked me the loaded question, well, what's your favorite church? And I didn't have an answer. And I've thought about that ever since. And then when Father Novak invited me for this lecture, since he was the priest who had asked that question, I thought I really had to have an answer. So here it is. And I would stumble through, whenever someone asked me that, I would stumble through the idea that, well, there's a beautiful chapel in Tuscany that's just, you feel the presence of God, you know, St. Peter's is fantastic, and but for me, that simplicity of a beautiful small chapel is what inspires me. So here's an example of what I was talking about. This is in a little town in Montegemoli, which is in Tuscany. No one's ever been there. You don't have to go. There's 49 people that live in the town. It's in the middle of nowhere. It's on 3,000 acres where you can hunt wild boar and dig for truffles, and just, it's the most beautiful place in the world. We happen to be doing some work over there with an Italian friend of ours who, you know, his family owns the town, the Borgo, the village. And it's just this wonderful time capsule. Leonardo da Vinci did a sketch of Montegemoli way back when. So it's been there for a while. And this is the little church in the little tiny village. It's nothing special on the outside. There's a parish priest who wanders in every once in a while and says a mass. If you want to see the church, you have to knock on the door across the piazza, and the little old lady, if she feels like it, will let you in to take a picture. Most of the time, she does. You don't pass muster and you don't get in. But this is the interior. And it's this wonderful stone church. I assume it's at least 500 years old. It might be closer to 700 or 800 years old. I don't know. It doesn't matter. It's, the walls are a little cockeyed. There's nothing magic about the materials. There's some halfway decent painting. The altar is nothing amazing. But all together, all of these things come to make this just a beautiful, sacred place. It's the proportion, it's the scale, it's the way it engages the senses. It just, for me, is a wonderfully transcendent space that is a great example that not every Catholic church has to be St. Peter's. In fact, it would probably be good if most of them were not, and were more intimate and more personal. So, that's my answer to your question, Father Nogue. So, as a conclusion, I really believe that beauty is a necessary and vital characteristic of a Catholic church. And looking to the traditions of our church to achieve that beauty is the most appropriate way to do that. In fact, a beautiful church is the most effective investment in stewardship that a parish can possibly make. What we build forms us, but what we build is also a reflection of who we are. A church standing on the street corner is what the Catholic Church is presenting to the rest of the world. 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, 365 days a year. It's what everyone sees as that's what the Catholic Church is. And it can either be a poor investment and a terrible reflection of who we are or who we should be as Catholics, or it can be a shining beacon, an inspiration, and a fundamentally effective evangelism tool. So I really appreciate the opportunity to come out and speak with you tonight. I'd be happy to answer a few questions. I know that we have at least one from the audience. I'll let you go, Richard.
One thing stood out, I'd like to just ask you to comment on. Our church is 52 feet wide, 52 feet high, and 152 feet long. So it's almost exactly three times as long as it is wide and high. I was just wondering, did the architect have something in mind when he chose those dimensions?
I'll answer that question by telling a story. Years ago, I had an engineer from Australia come and visit me in Washington, D.C. And he was very interested in church architecture. And he said he wanted to come see what we did. He wanted to go visit that church in Leesburg. He wanted to see how it all worked. And I said, sure, great. What I'm not going to say no. So this gentleman came. We drove out to Virginia, toured this church. He was suitably impressed. And then we went to a nice dinner in downtown Leesburg at this nice little restaurant. And he opened the wine list, and I don't know if anyone knows any Australians, but they have a reputation for drinking. Catholic Australians are in a whole nother category. So they had an Australian wine on the wine list, so we had to get three bottles. Had a wonderful dinner, and then he finally came out with his question. He said, you know, Art, he said, I have one question to ask, and I don't know how to ask it. I don't want to tread on your proprietary trade information. He happened to be the world's preeminent conveyor belt engineer. I didn't know that at the time, but he had this background in design and construction and drawing. And he said, that church we were just in, how did you proportion that church? What system did you use when you started the design? And I told him, you're not going to like the answer. He said, no, really, I really want to know. I said, there was none. And he was shocked. He said, you're kidding. It's beautiful. And I said, yes, it is. And if we went back now and overlaid the drawings with the golden section or with some other proportional system, it's going to be really close. But that's not where we start. We start with your gut and with what you've experienced and what you know looks about right. And then you work through it, you massage it, you design it. And in the end, you end up with something that is right. But you can't start with the diagram and the math. So the answer to your question is, I think those dimensions are just the way it ended up. I don't think the architect sat down and said, okay, it's going to be 52 by 52 by 152. It could have been 38 by 42 by whatever. But I think the result, if you actually went in and, you know, did the math and said, okay, it's three times this, there's a reason behind that because it looks right. It works like a church. And to be humble one more time, it takes us back to the eye of the idea of beauty being in the eye of the beholder, right? So as an architect, I've spent 30 years looking at churches, traveling to churches, drawing churches. And that experience has given me the ability to just now start to feel semi-confident that I can tell someone that's a pretty good-looking church. So that's the formation of that eye. And it's not just with art and architecture, it's with anything. You wouldn't go to a brain surgeon who's just out of school and say, I got this interesting way of doing this that, you know, nobody else really has tried before. And you want something that has the continuity. So, and that's a very non-humble way of saying it, but I'm not interviewing for a job, so I'm just being honest. So, did that answer your question? Good. Anyone else? Yes, ma'am.
I grew up going to St. Patrick's Church. Are you familiar with it?
I'm not.
Oh. St. Patrick's Church in Oklahoma City.
Okay.
Was built in the 60s by the parish. It is a concrete block. You should go look at it. 19th and Portland. I was wondering what I designed that church, because, like I said, we grew up in that, the The parish actually physically built it. They poured concrete, they laid slate. They physically did the whole thing, but it's the most cold, unattractive church that most people would say, what were they thinking? And, but it's won lots of awards, so that's my question is...
Of course.
How did that happen?
I was speaking to a group of young pastors about a week ago in our archdiocese, and about the importance of beauty in churches, and one of them said that he was an intern at the parish he was at, and one of his jobs had been going through the parish archives. And this church was had been renovated in the 60s, and they had taken a reasonably decent church and made it reasonably bad. And he found all the records for that project, the drawings, the bulletins, where the pastor had explained very passionately how what they were doing was the right thing to do, and it was important. It was what the church had to do to be relevant in the modern world. And his question was an interesting one. He said, you know, I think everyone agrees that this project made the church worse. He said, but here we had a pastor who was making very reasonable arguments, reasonable sounding arguments, and thought he was doing the right thing. So how do we, as pastors now, know that we're not going down the same road? We're not making those same mistakes. And that was the first time anyone had ever asked that question, because I spend a lot of time talking about how good it is, the stuff that we do, just like if I was an architect in 1965, I would have been probably saying the same thing about modern architecture. And I think that the distinction is that, you know, remembering that a human being can justify an awful lot, right? We can sell just about anything and spin just about anything. And maybe that's just because I live and work in Washington, D.C. Truth is, you can make an argument for just about anything. And in a vacuum, that argument can be valid. But it's only when you look back on the history and the tradition of the church that you realize, wait a minute, this doesn't look like a church anymore. And that's a problem. And it was interesting because I was an architect and I worked on churches for the first 10 years or so, and everyone told me, well, Vatican II says you have to do this. And I just assumed, well, they've read Vatican II. I'm a convert. So as I was getting rid of being Lutheran and becoming Catholic about 10 years ago, I actually sat down and read the documents of the Second Vatican Council, not in their entirety, but the relevant portions. And I was really shocked because the two clauses that I put up on the screen are the only reference to art and architecture in the entire document. And that was interpreted as, okay, now we're going to do this. Which is one way of looking at it if you're ignoring the tradition, the sacred tradition, which also says in the document is to be preserved. So ugly churches exist. They were built most of the time with the best of intentions, but they're still not good churches. And it's not just that they're not nice or pleasant. They're not doing their job well. If it was a more beautiful church, it would be forming its parish better. And that's not something that you can easily quantify, but you kind of sense it in your gut that it's not working the way it's supposed to. So you're not the first person who has had an ugly parish. You're not St. Patrick's. But the next question is usually, well, what do I do about my parish? We've got this church and it's uninspiring, and I usually show some pretty nice examples of ugly churches with green carpet. And the answer is you start at the sanctuary. You start there and radiate outwards. So if you've got $100 to spend, you buy nice candle stands. And if you've got $1,000 to spend, you buy a new tabernacle. And maybe you put a coat of paint on the wall. And maybe you get a nicer altar. And as you move out, in a lot of churches, you can't fix everything without a wrecking ball. But that doesn't mean that you can't make it more beautiful, right? So the two images I showed of the Butler Building on one side with a cross on the top and Blessed Stanley Rother on the other, there's a whole continuum in between the two. And regardless of what the budget is, you can make a beautiful church. It can be a simple church, but it can be beautiful, and it should. Any other questions? Yes, sir.
Thank you. So take the, I guess, the traditional style church that you kind of talked about a little bit. There are a lot of different features that, you know, are supposed to kind of guide us in our faith. Some pretty obvious, like kind of the cross-shaped floor plan, and some more subtle, kind of like, you know, the ribbed, you know, the roof that kind of looks like the bow of a ship or something like that. So my question is, in all of your research, what are some features that are kind of traditional that maybe get overlooked?
The architectural fee. No, that's Now that's a great question. And there are many things that have been diminished and lost over time. One of the things that I've just sort of rediscovered the importance of is the ombre. Who knows what an ombre is?
Say it again.
The ombre. It's where you store the sacred oils, three vials of oil. And it used to be a much more important part of the experience of a church, and we kind of went away from that. So now there's a box on the wall in the sacristy, or and it's not celebrated, it's not accentuated. So, and it's sort of an easy thing to kind of forget about and just, oh, we'll tack something up and we'll figure it out. But if you think about it, those oils are sacramental, well, I guess they're called sacramentals, right? They're sacramental elements. And that's a big part of not just our faith, but of being Catholic, right? The sacraments and someone with a collar could explain it better than I can, but the sacraments are tangible. They engage the senses. And that's a big part of what makes them so important to us as Catholics. So the ombre is one of those examples. There's also a tradition of sort of elements in the floor, right? In our parish church, we have, it's a crappy carpet, but in the border of the carpet, they have these Marian symbols, right? All the expressions of Our Lady. I don't think anybody else in the parish knows what that is, but it's there, right? At the cathedral, the Pastoral Center Chapel here in Oklahoma City, there's this wonderful terrazzo floor, and alternating up the aisle are these medallions describing the different orders, the different roles within the church. So you go from, and a lot of them are sort of ancient, old-timey, warden and lector, and then you get to deacon and priest. And so it's this wonderful reminder of our faith, and sort of the details that we kind of forget sometimes, because going to Mass on a Sunday is—it's a habit you get. It's something you just do. If it's something that you can be challenged to think about, right? If you experience things in the church that are a little unusual, a little different, your formation gets broadened. You're going to think, well, hey, where's our ombre? Right? Where's those elements that were part of the church that we've lost? And it's not that you can't be a good Catholic and go to Mass and make it to heaven without all those things. It's just that having those things, or having at least some of those things, helps your formation. It helps you become a better, more informed, more fully formed Catholic. Yes, sir. I don't know why his microphone works.
Thanks again for me personally, a fascinating presentation. I had an opportunity a few years ago to go to France, and there's an old monastery there in Fontainebleau, Our Lady of Fontainebleau, and we went on a men's retreat, but in the beautiful Abbey Church, it's so old, and like a lot of European churches today, and a lot of them are empty, unfortunately, on Sundays, but I remember we had a tour across the river of Fontainebleau, the village, the town, and it was started by, a hermit by the name of Gombo. And he lived in caves. He was established a hermitage. But I remember going into one of the caves, and very old, and you could tell it was lived in. But there was an old, what looked like an altar, and a box made out of stone, and a tabernacle. So every time I go to a Catholic church, I always notice that, traditional, I want to say, Catholic church, you go and look to the altar, and there's the tabernacle. And I have to admit, some of these churches, the modern churches, where you go in a church, and where's the Sanctus lamp? Where's the tabernacle? So as part of tradition, is that the architectural focus, is maybe the altar, I guess? And from there on, you work your way out, or?
Well, as I showed with the Temple of Solomon, right, there's the sanctuary where the priests were, and behind that was the Holy of Holies. And that's where the Ark of the Covenant was. That's where God was. And that curtain in the temple between that place where only one priest went once a year, that was the most sacred place on earth. The curtain that was ripped at the moment of Christ's death. That is what the tabernacle is for us. In the Temple of Solomon, it was the Ark of the Covenant. For us, it is the real presence of Christ in the tabernacle. So for me, that tabernacle is and should be on center beyond the altar of sacrifice. It's the presence of Christ. Again, there are arguments to be made that it would be nice to have the Blessed Sacrament in its own chapel. And I'm not sure that I completely disagree with that, except for what you just said, where you walk into a church and you don't know what you're kneeling in front of. So it's not that there has to be things in a Catholic church have to be exactly like this. Just like with the proportions, there's not a formula that says yes or no, right? This is the only way to do it. But there's an awful big bias towards doing it in the continuity of tradition. So once you separate yourself from that, you have to have a really good reason for doing something differently. And that should be the extreme exception and not the rule that every church does its own thing. So is that sort of answering your question? Good. Yes, ma'am.
What church is this you don't explain?
This is a picture of a convent chapel in Nashville, Tennessee for the Dominican House of, well, not the Dominican House of Studies, the Dominican Sisters in Nashville. We did this chapel for them about 15 years ago.
It reminds me of a church I visited in Boston along the Freedom Trail, mm-hmm. King's Church, I think it's called.
Okay.
Because they had, like, I guess they call them family boxes.
Mm-hmm.
Can you, like, tell us about that, or do you know? Or
no, it's I think it's a pretty uniquely American thing. Particularly in Protestant churches, before central heating, each of the pews was a box. You know, there was a waist-high wall around each of the pews. And as a family, you would, you know, if you were good for it, you know, your contributions paid for that pew, and as long as you kept putting money in the collection plate, you were in good graces, and you could sit in that pew. And maybe it's not a bad idea. But you would bring in an urn with hot coals, and you would put that in under the seat in your box, and that would keep the box reasonably warm. I went to an Episcopal high school in rural Maryland, and they had a church from 16 something, and it was all these boxed pews. And it's a wonderful, you know, get a little door that you open to go and receive communion, and all. It's interesting. I'm sure there are Catholic churches that do that, but it's not particularly common. I just happen to like this image. And again, it's an example of one size doesn't fit all. This is this convent chapel, and they have what's called antiphonal seating. So instead of all of the pews facing the altar, some of the pews face in towards the center, and the sisters sit in those pews and face each other and sing the Mass and sing their worship. And it's absolutely beautiful, but it creates these interesting seating arrangements that you don't typically see. So, and I just thought it was a nice photo, so we'd like to include it.
Thank you, Art, so much for being with us tonight. Everyone, let's thank him. And
thank you very much.
And one of your future visits, I'll take you to St. Patrick's and we can look at it.
Oh, thanks.
Because honestly, I kind of like it. So it's a thing, and it's a mid-century modern thing. But anyway, I'll have happy. In fact, I take our eighth graders on an architecture tour each year, and we go to like five different churches, and we go around, and they always vote that St. Patrick's is their favorite. I'm like, what? But I think they just grow up with this. They're tired of this. It's so different. They're just used to ours. Anyway, thank you so much. Our next St. Francis Talks is going to be on Tuesday, December the 14th. It's Our Lady of Guadalupe. You won't want to miss this. It's right around the feast day, but it's going to be, I've heard this, one of our directors out at the Chancery, Luis Soto, he told the telling of this story, which I've heard many times, but he does it in such a beautiful way, inspiring way, and I really want our parish to hear, or anyone to hear this story. So anyway, write that down. Again, thank you all for coming tonight. And I'd like to give you a blessing before we head out the door. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
May Almighty God bless you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Thank you again for coming tonight. God bless you all.
Thank you, Father.
Once we got the sound.